this scenario is a little bit hard to see on the slides that follow, but it's basically about setting up the hypotheses for this situation to test this claim and then to go through the seven hypotheses steps. An earlier video set up the hypotheses for this problem. The candle making company advertises, our new holiday candle will last longer than the entire holiday season with average use. Assume the holiday season refers to calendar dates between Halloween and New Year's Day, and that average use means burning for 1 hour per day. Write down the hypotheses. Recall that the null hypothesis must contain a statement of equality, and that we always assume that the null hypothesis is true. In this problem, we will assume that the mean lifetime of all of these candles is equal to 63 hours. The alternate hypothesis H1 must always be a statement of inequality. In this case, we have that mu is greater than 63 hours. It comes from the claim. The claim will either be the null or the alternate hypothesis. In this case, the claim, or what was advertised, is that our new holiday candle will last longer than the entire holiday season. Writing the hypotheses is the first of seven steps for performing a hypothesis test. In this video, we will discuss the remaining steps. The null hypothesis is that there is no effect, and the alternate hypothesis is there is an effect. In this case, the alternate is the claim that these are rather splendidly engineered candles and they will last a long time. The null is, no they're not, they may not last very long. The null and the alternate hypotheses are complements. If the null is true, then the alternate must be false and vice versa. We assume that the null hypothesis is true and we are trying to reject that hypothesis. We obtain evidence to reject the null from a sample statistic obtained from a single sample of size n. If that sample statistic is unusual under the null hypothesis, then we reject the null hypothesis. Otherwise, we fail to reject the null hypothesis. Those are the only two allowable decisions. If the sample statistic is unusual, there are two possible explanations. The first is that the null hypothesis is true, and what occurred by chance. The other explanation is that the null hypothesis is false. Since the hypotheses here are about the population mean mu, evidence to reject will be based on unusual values of the point estimate for mu, which is the sample mean x bar. The alternate hypothesis tells us where unusual values of the sample statistic are. In this case, the alternate hypothesis is that mu is greater than 63, meaning that the unusual values of x bar causing rejection of the null will be unusually high. Step two is to define what do we mean by usual and unusual values of the sample statistic, or here, x bar. The symbol is the Greek letter alpha, and it stands for the significance level. In simpler terms, the significance level answers the question of what is unusual. In this case, it answers the question of what is an unusually high sample mean X bar if the null hypothesis is true, which means if mu really is 63 hours. Unusually high or significantly high or low values of X have been a recurring theme throughout the semester. The only difference now is that since we have a hypothesis test about the population mean mu, we're interested in unusually high values of X bar instead of X. Suppose that our alpha level is 0.05. This means that the upper 5% of all X bars are unusually high, while the lower 95% of X bars are usual values. In the sampling distribution of the X bars, under the assumption that the mean of the X's, not X bars, is 63 hours, as we have assumed true under the null hypothesis. Remember our good friend, the central limit theorem. that said that if the parent distribution X is normal or N is greater than 30, then the mean of the sampling means, or mu X bar, is the mean of the parent distribution. And furthermore, the standard error, or the standard deviation of the X bars, is sigma divided by the square root of the sample size. Furthermore, the sampling distribution of the X bars is approximately normal, even for distributions where the parent distribution X is not normal. If the parent distribution is normal, then the sampling distribution of the X bars is exactly normal. Now combine this with the fact that we have assumed that the null hypothesis is true, in particular the equality part. Then the mean of the parent distribution X, the candle burning times, is 63 hours, but so is the mean of the sampling means mu X bar. Now from the alternate hypothesis, we know that the unusual values of the sample statistic X bar is in the right tail. From step two, the significance level, we know that the unusually high values are the upper alpha percent of all X bars. Step three is, what is the sampling distribution of the sample means X bar? We had before, by the central limit theorem, that if X is normal or the sample size N is greater than 30, then the distribution of the X bars can be standardized as Z is X bar minus mu X bar over sigma X bar, or X bar minus mu divided by sigma divided by the square root of the sample size. This would give us the standard normal distribution with mean zero in standard deviation one. But there's a problem here. We don't know sigma. Therefore, we must estimate sigma with our single sample size of size N with a sample standard deviation S. Then we must use the student T distribution instead, where the only difference is sigma is replaced by the sample standard deviation. Student T is a family of bell-shaped curves with a different bell-shaped curve for each degree of freedom. Recall that if the sample size N is greater than 30, then student T is approximately standard normal. If the sample size is less than or equal to 30, then the bell-shaped curve has the same mean, or zero, but a larger standard deviation, meaning that the tails are thicker. In step three, you should draw the T distribution annotating where the unusually high T values corresponding to unusually high X bars are that will cause rejection of the null hypothesis, and where the usual values are that will result in a decision of fail to reject the null hypothesis. Note that for your T statistic, the X bar will come from your single sample of size N, as will the sample standard deviation S. However, the mean will come from the null hypothesis, in particular, the equality value of 63 hours for this particular problem. Steps 1 through 3 should be completed before step 4, which is to draw your sample. It is unethical to draw your sample and then go back and change your hypotheses and your alpha level. Write down your inputs, which includes the sample size, the degrees of freedom, or sample size minus one, your alpha level from step two, your calculated X bar from your sample, your calculated sample standard deviation S, and then calculate your T statistic using mu is 63 hours for this particular problem from the null hypothesis. Record that value. You should always ask yourself the question, does your sample statistic, here X bar, support the null or does it support the alternate? It will be one of the two. If in this case, with a null of mu less than or equal to 63 hours, if you got, for example, an X bar of 62 hours, stop right there. There's no need to proceed. You cannot possibly reject the null hypothesis. In other words, in your T distribution, is that X bar will produce a T statistic that's in the fail to reject H naught region. However, if you get a sample X bar greater than 63 hours for this particular problem, it is possible that you could reject the null hypothesis in favor of the alternate hypothesis. Then you should proceed to the following steps. Now that you have your test statistic, your t-statistic from step four, it's time to calculate the p-value or probability value. The p-value is a probability of a test statistic as or more extreme, in this case right tail, than that in your sample. In this case, there are two formulas for calculating the p-value for a right tail t sample. One is equal 1 minus t dot distribution, or DIST. Input the t sample from step 4. Degrees of freedom is n minus 1, and cumulative is 1, or true. Or you could use equal t dot dis dot rt, that means right tail, t sample, degrees of freedom is n minus 1. Step 6 is to make your decision. You do that by comparing the p-value to your significance level alpha. Alpha is the definition of what is unusual, in this case, unusually high. The p-value is how unusual was your observed test statistic. There are two possible decisions. If the p-value is less than your alpha level, you will reject the null hypothesis. If this is the case, you're subject to a type 1 error, or you have detected an effect that's not there. Remember, the null hypothesis is there is no effect. These candles will burn for a while and then burn out. There's no real engineering to them. Whereas the alternate is, yes, they will last a long time. A type 1 error can also be thought of as a court of law, where the null hypothesis is the defendant is innocent until proved guilty beyond all reasonable doubt. If you convict an innocent person, then you have committed a type 1 error, or you have detected an effect that the defendant is guilty when there is no effect or the defendant is actually innocent. The other possibility is that you fail to reject the null hypothesis because the p-value is greater than or equal to alpha. Then you are subject to a type 2 error, which is failing to detect an effect that is there. In this case, this would mean that the mean lifetime of all these candles really is greater than 63 hours, but you failed to detect that. In a court of law, where the null hypothesis is the defendant is innocent and the alternate is he or she is guilty, if you fail to convict a guilty defendant, you have committed a type 2 error. Note that it's not possible to know for most populations of interest whether or not you have committed a type 1 or a type 2 error. In this case, not only do you not know the mean lifetime of these candles, it's not knowable. Many of these candles have already burned out, and they're still making them. The seventh and final step is to put the results of the hypothesis test in layman terms for someone who may or may not know very much about statistics. Here are eight basic things that should be touched on. At a significance level of alpha, state what it is in words and then say what the significance level is. There either is or is not enough evidence. If you reject the null, with this single sample of size n, there was enough evidence. If you fail to reject the null, then no, there's not enough evidence. 2, 3, reject or support the claim. If the claim is the null, the word is reject. You cannot support a claim that is the null hypothesis. If you want to support a claim, it must be the alternate hypothesis. The claim. Now talk about the claim. That the what? State the population parameter. That would be mu here, or mean lifetime mu. Say it in words and then give the symbol. Then if it is about mu, it's a measurement. If the hypothesis test was about the population proportion of successful trials, p, which is also known as the binomial probability of success on a single trial, instead of measurement, it would be what is a success. Here it is the lifetime of the candles. 4, the word is all because the hypotheses are about a population parameter always. all units, state what the experimental units are, or the observational units, or just units, candles here. In the population, that would be a candle brand of some type here, is state the interval of values for the parameter. That would be more than 63 hours here. Hopefully that has enlightened you on some of the intrinsic beauty and wonderments of hypothesis testing, and they lived happily ever after.